Welcome, friends, to our online Easter service. This is certainly an Easter unlike any I have ever witnessed. We are happy to share the joy of Christ's resurrection with you through our online platform. Come, let us go up to Zion, says the prophet Jeremiah. Let us join in prayer. Holy God, our songs are subdued. Our church building is quiet. We miss the joy of celebrating Easter with one another. Yet, you still love us with an everlasting love. You are still faithful to us. This Easter day is unusually calm for some and overly busy for others. Today, seal hope within our hearts. Make us into signs of hope for one another. It is in the name of the risen Christ that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls. Happy Easter. Today is the day that we celebrate Jesus' resurrection. It's a really big, long word. Can you say that word with me? Resurrection. It means that Jesus is not dead. He is alive. And on Easter Sunday, we say, He is risen. He is risen indeed. Can you all say that with me? He is risen. He is risen indeed. And then we usually say hallelujah, which means yay. Hallelujah is just a big fancy word for saying yay. This is a great day, and it's one that we love to celebrate in the life of our church. And today I'm going to read you the story of the women going to the tomb, seeing Jesus for the very first time. So this comes from our storybook Bible, and it is based on the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So there's a little bit of each of the stories in those Gospels, and this is the story from all of them together. And it is called God's Wonderful Surprise. Jesus' friends were sad. They would never see their best friend again. How did this happen? Wasn't Jesus the rescuer, the king God had promised? It wasn't supposed to end like this. Yes, but whoever said anything about the end? Just before sunrise on the third day, God sent an earthquake and an angel from heaven. When the guards who were guarding the tomb saw the angel, they fell down with fright. The angel rolled the huge stone away, sat on top of it, and waited. At the first glimmer of dawn, Mary Magdalene and other women headed to the tomb to wash Jesus' body. The early morning sun slanted through the ancient olive trees, drops of dew glittering on leaves and grasses, little tears everywhere. The friends walked quietly along the hilly path through the olive groves until they reached the tomb, and immediately they noticed that something was odd. The tomb was wide open. They peered through the opening into the dark tomb. But wait, Jesus' body was gone. And something else, a shining man was there with clothes made from lightning. They were terrified. But don't be scared, the angel said. They couldn't help it. They screamed anyway. The angel asked them, What are you doing here? This is a tomb, and tombs are for dead people. The women were so surprised and so frightened, they couldn't speak. Jesus isn't dead anymore, the angel said. He's alive again. And at that news, their hearts leaped in their chest. And then the angel laughed with such gladness that they felt for a moment as if they had woken from a nightmare. The other women rushed home, but Mary stayed behind. She was still sad and confused and frightened. How could it be true? Jesus was definitely dead. How could he be alive? She wondered. Just then, Mary heard someone else in the garden. Perhaps it's the gardener, she thought. I bet he'll know where Jesus' body is. Mary said to the gardener, I don't know where Jesus is. I can't find him. Do you know where he is? But it was all right. Jesus knew where Mary was, and Jesus had found her. Mary, he said to her. Only one person said her name like that. She could hear her heart thumping. She turned around. She could just make out a figure. She shaded her eyes to see. She thought she was dreaming, but she wasn't dreaming. She was seeing. Jesus, she said. Mary fell to the ground. Suddenly, tears filled her eyes and great sobs shook her whole body. All she wanted in that moment was to cling to Jesus and to never let him go. You'll be able to hold on to me later, Mary, Jesus said gently, and you will always be close to me. But now I need you to go and tell the others that I am alive. Mary ran and ran all the way to the city. She had never run so fast or so far in all her life. She felt she could have run forever. She didn't even feel like her feet touched the ground. The sun seemed to be dancing and gleaming and bounding across the sky, racing with her and shining brighter than she could ever remember in the clear, fresh air. And it seemed to her that morning as she ran, almost as if the whole world had been made anew, almost as if the whole world was singing for joy. The trees, tiny sounds in the grass, the birds, her heart. Was God really making everything sad come untrue? Was God really making even death come untrue? She couldn't wait to tell Jesus' friends. They won't believe it, she laughed. And she was right, of course. But we boys and girls, we know the story that Jesus is alive. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. And one thing that I hope that you have done over these days, and if you haven't done it yet, you can still do it, is I hope that you have colored your Alleluia butterflies. This is one that I did. It took me a while. I colored it a little bit and put it away, and then colored it a little bit away and put it away. But I want you to color your Alleluia butterflies and cut them out and hold on to them. And when we are back together in this building, I want you to bring your Alleluia butterflies, and we will put them around the church and celebrate together, being back together as community, remembering that God's love is powerful, and it's more powerful than anything we can imagine, even death, that God is always with us, even when we are in our homes, not with anybody else, but our families. God is still with us. God loves us. And God cares for us always. So bring back your butterflies, and I will see you soon, I hope. Happy Easter, boys and girls. I love you and I miss you.
Our first scripture reading comes from the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 1 through 6. At that time, says the Lord, I will be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus says the Lord, the people who survived the sword found grace in the wilderness. When Israel sought for rest, the Lord appeared to him from far away. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. Again, I will build you, and you shall be built, O virgin Israel. Again, you shall take your tambourines and go forth in the dance of the merrymakers. Again, you shall plant vineyards on the mountains of Samaria. The planters shall plant and enjoy the fruit. For there shall be a day when sentinels will call in the hill country of Ephraim, come, let us go up to Zion, to the Lord our God. Here ends the reading.
Our New Testament lesson today comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Hear now God's word for you. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying,
one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabuni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brother and say to them, go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them all that he had said to her. Here ends the reading. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
About 4 weeks ago, I was scared. We were just getting news of the coronavirus in North Carolina. Everything seemed like it was crashing down. No one knew what lay ahead, and no one seemed to know what to do. Here in North Carolina, we know how to deal with crisis. We have weathered hurricanes and tornadoes without number, all the ups and downs of North Carolina weather. But this storm, this was different, and it still is. And so about a month ago, I felt as though I were staring into this vast emptiness. Not like the empty tomb of Easter, just empty. What did Mary and the disciples feel when they first saw the empty tomb? The various gospel accounts portray that first Easter morning as rather frightening, or sad, or just difficult to comprehend, or some combination of all of those things. Imagine yourself in that Easter story, running with Peter and the other disciple to the tomb, standing there weeping with Mary Magdalene, wondering what is happening. Maybe imagine yourself as a bystander. I have a feeling that whichever person you chose, you, and I know certainly I, can identify with at least someone in this Easter account. Look at what happened to the disciples. They ran to see the empty tomb. They saw wrappings lying there. One of them was even all folded up. The other disciple believed, yet they still did not fully understand. They did not know exactly what they should do at this point after witnessing this sight. So they just went home. Many of us are at home most of the time, if not all of the time. We are just waiting. The Gospel of John relates that after that first Easter morning, the disciples actually stayed waiting, wondering, afraid of what might happen next. My thoughts are especially with those of you who would be working at this time, but have been furloughed or laid off, and you too are wondering what will happen next. The disciples go in, they run, they go back home. Mary stays, and she weeps. This year, we also have a sad Easter, with weeping across our country and across our world. Her weeping does not last too terribly long, however, because she sees Jesus. Then she gets to work. My thoughts are with so many of you who are at work today, working long hours, working in stressful environments, taking care of people, taking care of food and the necessities of life, health. Mary gets to work immediately on that Easter morning, going back to preach the message I have seen the Lord. And so, friends, it is a different Easter. It is still Easter. Nothing that we are going through right now takes away from the resurrection of Jesus. Nothing we are enduring at this moment diminishes the power of new life in Christ. Easter is more than a day. Easter is an entire season, stretching until the day of Pentecost. And so during this season, I invite you to celebrate with me. Even though we are physically apart, I invite you to celebrate, knowing that nothing diminishes the joy of new life in Christ. To celebrate together, I would love for you to share with me and with the church a sign of new life. It could be a photo, or it could be a short story or a quote that you like, and we will share those in turn with the rest of the church. I'll begin. I would like to share a story I read on the Presbyterian Church USA website. A small church on the eastern shore of Maryland has among its members a semi-retired big rig truck driver. He wondered during this coronavirus crisis if he could do anything to help. Turns out a friend of his was making stainless steel parts for ventilators, and the friend needed someone to drive a rig to New York City for delivery. So the truck driver, who still had his license but was a bit out of practice, volunteered. I looked up the location where the driver delivered the parts, a teeny tiny side street just across the East River from Manhattan. I have no idea how he got a big rig in there for delivery. The driver himself, when he was interviewed, said there was no room for error on his trip. Everything went perfectly. The supplies were delivered. He was able to contribute. His friend was able to contribute. We don't know what happened to the supplies after they were delivered, but we know they went for the purpose of saving lives. This is a story of new purpose, new directions, new hope for those who were worried about a shortfall in medical equipment. We have our own stories today of new purpose, new directions, new hope. And so, in the midst of our tears or our confusion, with our overworked selves or our underworked selves, we still have new life. In the midst of whatever is going on now, the risen Christ can and does still appear. I hope that you will share a story with us about new hope, about new life. This is just one of many that I know are happening all across our nation and our world right now. And so, friends, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Happy Easter, and may this celebration be very special to you. Amen. Please join me in affirming our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Mighty God, Father of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, we have so many prayers today. We pray for those who are ill with COVID-19 and those who care for them, those with compromised immune systems and with other medical problems still needing treatment, for workers laid off or furloughed, for workers in the hospitality and restaurant and food industries, for healthcare staff and first responders, for teachers and students working through online lessons. These particulars are just a small representation of all those who are sad, suffering, or anxious at this time. We name others silently before you. Lord, stand near those who weep. Encourage those who work. Inspire hope in those worried about the future. Awaken new life within us. Make us into ministers of your good news this week. The needs of this world are great. Help us be responsive to those needs. Send your Spirit among us. Draw us together in hearts and souls, even though we are physically apart. Help us to find the joy of Easter in our hearts, in our homes, in the sunrise and in the rain. We pray as our risen Lord taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Alleluia. Christ is risen. Amen.